The present EKG is obtained from a 64-year-old male with history of mitral valve replacement and ischemic heart disease, presented with palpitation and chest pain. On physical exam, he has tachycardia and the hemodynamic is stable. What do you think about this strip? Which of the following is the correct answer? 1. AV nodal reentrant tachycardia. 2. Atrial tachycardia. 3. Atrial fibrillation. 4. Atrial flutter. What are you going to do for this patient? Like before, to interpret every electrocardiogram properly, use the 10-step approach. First of all, start with standard values. In this strip, the calibration marker is one large box wide and two large boxes high. Thereby, this is a standardized 12-lead electrocardiogram. Next is cardiac rhythm. There are inverted P waves at rate of 335 beats per minute in inferior leads, forming a sawtooth pattern. The atrial activity is visible in V1 as well. In addition, the QRS complexes are narrow, regular, and uniform. The ratio of P waves to QRS complexes is 2 to 1. So, the underlying rhythm is undoubtedly atrial flutter with 2 to 1 conduction. Note that, some flutter waves are buried within QRS complexes and therefore are not visible. On the other hand, certain flutter waves are immediately before QRS complexes forming intermittent pseudo-Q waves. As a general rule, intermittent Q, R, or S wave is in favor of superimposed P waves on QRS complexes, and is usually observed in heart blocks or atrial arrhythmias, especially atrial tachycardia or atrial flutter. In summary, the rhythm is atrial flutter with fixed 2-to-1 heart block. Next step is calculating heart rate. Since the RR intervals are stable and about 9 small boxes, the overall ventricular response is approximately 166 beats per minute. Then we should go through axis determination. QRS complexes are positive in both leads 1 and 2. Thereby, the axis is normal. Next thing is wave morphology and intervals. As we said earlier, thanks to atrial flutter, the P waves are inverted in inferior leads and upright in V1. Remember that, without an exception, sinus P waves are always expected to be positive in leads 1, 2, and AVF. But here, P waves are inverted in inferior leads, and therefore are non-sinus due to the arrhythmia. The amplitude of QRS complexes is greater than 5 mm in limb leads and 10 mm in precordial leads. None of the criteria of ventricular hypertrophy is present as well. So, the complexes are neither low nor high voltage. The QRS complexes are narrow. Additionally, the transition zone occurs in V4 and therefore is normal. Lastly, no pathological Q wave is present in this strip. In summary, the QRS complexes have no abnormal changes. Afterwards, we should calculate QT interval. Note that, during tachyarrhythmias, measurement of QT interval is very difficult and time-consuming. So, it's preferred to postpone calculating QT interval until the arrhythmia is terminated. The last thing in examining wave morphologies and intervals is ST segment and T wave changes. Fortunately, there is no obvious abnormal ST segment deviation or T wave inversion in this strip. So, both ST segment and T wave are generally normal. Note that, isolated T wave inversion in lead 3 is a normal variant and has no clinical significance. The final step is overall interpretation. Before going through this part, if you have liked this video so far, please subscribe me and ring the bell. In order to interpret the EKG properly, we should make a list of abnormal findings. Atrial flutter at rate of 166 beats per minute is the only abnormal finding in this strip. Let's have a brief and to-the-point review over atrial flutter. One of the most misdiagnosed dysrhythmias in all settings is atrial flutter with 2-to-1 conduction. Atrial flutter is a kind of supraventricular tachycardia that is most often caused by a counterclockwise macro-reentry around the tricuspid valve in the right atrium. The electrocardiographic findings in atrial flutter are as follow. Regular atrial activity at rate of 250 to 350 beats per minute, which is the hallmark of atrial flutter. Atrial activity produces a sawtooth pattern of inverted flutter waves in inferior leads. The flutter waves are most often upright in V1, that may be misdiagnosed as sinus tachycardia. Lastly, flutter waves most often result in wavy baseline. There is a common misunderstanding about the ventricular response in atrial flutter. Many of us think that ventricular response in atrial flutter is exclusively regular, but that's not true. Depending on the conduction ratio, the rhythm can be regular or irregular. Atrial flutter with fixed conduction ratio like 2 to 1, 3 to 1, and 4 to 1 is regular, but variable AV conduction results in irregular rhythms. Atrial flutter is clinically very important. First of all, always keep in mind that atrial flutter is extremely rare in structurally normal hearts. So, every patient with atrial flutter must be carefully evaluated for any underlying cardiac and non-cardiac diseases. Here is the list of diseases associated with atrial flutter. In most studies, nearly 60% of patients with atrial flutter have congestive heart failure, coronary artery disease, or hypertensive heart disease. As you see, various non-cardiac conditions, including thyrotoxicosis, obesity, obstructive sleep apnea, sinus node dysfunction, pericarditis, pulmonary diseases like pneumonia and pulmonary embolism, can develop atrial flutter as well. Atrial flutter rarely occurs as a chronic rhythm. Very often, it converts to normal sinus or deteriorates to atrial fibrillation. Therefore, atrial flutter and atrial fibrillation are frequently associated arrhythmias. Thanks for watching this video. If you are eager to learn more about electrocardiogram and test your skills in EKG interpretation, subscribe me and ring the bell. Good luck!